Welcome back to the class. We'll be seeing a new chapter, genetics and health. There is a lot to be included in genetics, but we will be primarily discussing what is important from the public health standpoint of view and what is frequently asked in the examinations. So this is a power capsule for all the genetics that is usually asked in the examination. You have, like I said, a lot of knowledge in genetics. You have those chromosomes, disorders, Mendelian inheritance and a lot of other stuff, but that is usually not asked in the examination. So what is asked in the examination, we will be basically focusing on that, so that as far as community medicine is concerned, you have a high yield dose of frequently asked topics. With that, let us start with genetics. All of you know that there are autosomal dominant disorders and males and females are affected in equal frequencies in an autosomal dominant disorder. Probability of an offspring will be affected is 50%. So there is a 50% chance that an offspring will be affected. Disease does not occur in offsprings of unaffected individuals. Since it is an autosomal dominant, if it is present, it shows. If it is absent, it's absent. So there's no show. Shows great variability in manifestations. Since they are autosomal dominant, God has been kind enough to make them at least some milder disease. So autosomal dominant usually are milder diseases, and they show a phenomenon which is called as incomplete penetrance, which means sometimes they skip generations. You hear your relatives or friends saying that this child looks like his grandfather. He does not look like his father, but he looks like his grandfather, or he has got some traits of his grandfather. So that is incomplete penetrance, a trait which skipped one generation and directly skipped to the another. So that is a phenomenon which is described with autosomal dominant disorders of incomplete penetrance. And generally, as we saw, these are milder diseases as compared to the autosomal recessive. On the next slide, what you are seeing right in front of you is the disease inheritance pattern of autosomal diseases. Everybody knows this inheritance pattern. Again, an affected individual has a 50-50 likelihood of getting an affected child, and as you can see, it spares nobody. Since it is autosomal dominant, it has got absolutely nothing to do with the sex chromosomes, and therefore you can see a male and a female is affected, and again, if somebody is affected, it passes on because it is autosomal dominant. So this is typical a pedigree chart of a autosomal dominant disorder. Few autosomal dominant disorders, actually telling them as few would be a cruel joke. There are a lot many, but then you can mark the important ones and you can remember which are the really important autosomal dominant disorders. I did not mark it for you because then it is a very subjective thing. Sometimes some diseases are asked which are not common according to somebody else's perspective, but they may be important for somebody else. So this is a very long list. You can have the important ones remembered. Sometimes it can be a straight question. Which of the following is not an autosomal dominant disorder? So in that scenario, you at least need to have the important list of diseases which are included under autosomal dominant. Autosomal recessive disorders. Autosomal recessive disorders manifest in homozygous states, which means both alleles are there, both alleles have the problem, you have a disease. If one allele is there, another allele is normal, autosomal recessive does not manifest. So that is the meaning of the word recessive. So that is what it manifests only in homozygous state. Affected individuals are generally offsprings of heterozygous parents. Both the parents are affected, but they have the traits. They are not having the disease, they have the traits. And when these traits come together, say the child gets one copy, second copy from his mother, but both were having the disease, both were having traits of the disease, then the child gets the disease. These guys don't have the disease, they have the traits. They give genes to their kids, but the genes are passed with the traits. So now it is a homozygous state. I have one trait, and I have a homozygous state. So therefore you get the disease. That is autosomal recessive. As you know, there is a 25% chance of offspring having a normal phenotype, 50% probability of heterozygous, and 25% chance of a homozygous recessive allele. If I have to draw up,
okay, you have A here and here.
So you have 25% chance of having a normal phenotype. This guy is normal. Okay, so 1 of 4 is normal. That is a 25% chance. 50% probability of heterozygous. These two are heterozygous. Okay, so 2 out of 4 is 50% chance of heterozygous children, and you have a 25% chance of a homozygous person. So this guy got the disease. Okay, he is homozygous, so he got the disease. So 25% chance for a homozygous person having the disease. So this is a typical inheritance pattern of an autosomal recessive disorder. It is more common in consanguineous marriages, we know that. So marrying in community, close contacts, increases the risk of autosomal recessive disorders. And clinical features for autosomal recessive disorders are generally severe as compared to autosomal dominant. You can see in front of you right now a pedigree chart showing you a pattern of autosomal recessive disorder. So as you can see, these guys not affected, but when two people marry with the traits, they can have a affected children. As long as you have a trait but the another allele is okay, it has got no problem, you don't have the disease. As soon as you have two people marrying and having a children and they pass on the defective gene here, and in a homozygous state you get the disease. So this is a inheritance pattern of an autosomal recessive disorder. Again, an exhausting and indaunting list of autosomal recessive disorders, a very long list. Choose, pick yours. So what do you want? You can remember. If you can remember all of them, it is good. Okay, please go ahead and do that. Coming to the X-linked dominant disorder. X-linked dominant disorder is a very, very rare disorder. In fact, I mean, it is just for academic interest that X-linked dominant is described. Both heterozygous females and hemizygous males are affected because it is X-linked. To tell you, everybody knows that a male has an XY and a female has an XX. I hope you know that. Okay, XX and XY. And now the disorder that I am talking about is an X-linked dominant. So this guy has a problem. So no matter what the other guy says, he says, okay, I will have the disease. So you get a disease. If you have an X-linked dominant, it has to manifest. So both heterozygous females and hemizygous males are affected. All sons of affected male are normal and all daughters are affected. All sons are affected, of affected male are normal, because all sons of this guy would be having the Y chromosome. He is not going to pass his X chromosome and therefore it is a boy. And since he is just going to pass his Y chromosome, this will be a normal child. So this will be a normal child. All daughters would be affected, because if she is a daughter, essentially the father gave her an X chromosome and that X chromosome was a disease carrying dominant trait, and therefore she definitely will have the disease. If you know basic genetics, this is pretty easy. Dominant has to manifest. Affected females transmit the disease to half of their sons and half of their daughters because they have two X chromosomes. So obviously they have a 50-50% chance of splitting their X chromosomes, and the disease is more severe in males. Again, this is very easy to understand. Why is the disease more severe in males? See, I have two copies of X here. So the another X would try to balance the defect that this guy has. But here, if I have another copy of Y chromosome, you know that is a very small chromosome, has got just tiny beanie bits of genetic data. So all that the X says happens. There is no opposing action. So therefore the disease would be very much severe in the males as compared to the females, because females have a second normal X chromosome. Males, we don't have the other X chromosome. We just have a Y chromosome. So therefore we don't have the balance there. So whatever the X chromosome says happens. So the disease is more severe in males. Examples, these are rare examples, so it would be interesting to remember them. You have vitamin D resistant rickets, a peculiar form of rickets, and you have orofacial digital syndrome and incognitania pigmenti, some disease incognitia pigmenti. So these are the three examples of X-linked dominant disorder. Remember, they are rare, the list is very small, you would want to know them. This is how an X-linked dominant goes. So wherever the dominant X goes, you have the disease. If X goes, you have. If X is absent, you don't have. X of a father, we saw, it is going to a I mean, XY goes to, if he has a son, he has a Y, he has got no X, so he will be normal. If this X goes anywhere and that would go to a daughter, she will have the disease. So that is what is shown on the pedigree chart. X-linked recessive disorders. Usually present in males and present in homozygous females. So that is X-linked recessive, transmitted by healthy female carrier and or affected males if they survive to reproduce. So X-linked recessive disorder, we will see the pedigree chart here. This is an X-linked recessive inheritance. The long list of X-linked recessive disorders is again in front of you. Pick yours. Coming to the problems with chromosomes. You have many problems with chromosomes and many diseases which arise because of those. The first on your list is non-disjunction, which means that the chromosomes simply do not break as they are supposed to. What can happen is you can either have a monosomy or a trisomy. So a chromosome was supposed to split and one goes there, one comes here, it does not split. So I get 2 plus 1 here and 1 here. What I wanted was, I wanted 2 here and I wanted 2 here. Somewhere down the line somebody decides I don't want to split, and therefore you have a numerical anomaly. This is called as monosomy and this is called as a trisomy, because it has 3 copies of that chromosome and this guy only has 1. So this is a numerical error. Most of the time such fetuses will be aborted. Numerical errors are usually not tolerated, but there are some notable examples. Coming to the second thing, that is translocation. Translocation is when a piece of the chromosome breaks and it goes and joins to the other. So that is called as a translocation. Say for example you have this and this, it gets joined to another chromosome, probably this and this. So it gets joined with another chromosome and that is called as translocation. Deletion is simple. Deletion is I have this chromosome and a part simply got deleted. So this part simply got deleted, that is loss of genetic data, that is deletion. Duplication. Duplication is instead of getting deleted, what that part decided is I want to come 2 times. So you had this part, then this part 1 times, again I have that part and then the remaining chromosome. So this genetic material which was supposed to be there only once is now there twice. So therefore that is duplication. Inversion, the next thing, I have this chromosome, it broke off here, went the other way around. So if this was the A end and this was the B end, there are no A ends and B ends. This is just for explanation. Okay, don't go and say A ends and B ends. This is just for explanation. Then you have a B here and an A here. So that is an inversion. This piece simply rotates and rejoins. That is an inversion. So you have these kinds of problems with chromosomes happening. You can also have an interesting condition which is called as an isochromosome. Isochromosome is, you know that a chromosome has a long arm and a short arm. Okay, so 2 chromosomes are there and they decide, okay, let us make an isochromosome. What do? They join these 2 short arms and you get 2 long arms. Not happy. Okay, this is not good. I wanted something like this, but what happened is that there is a joining of short arms here and only 2 long arms here. I want 1 long and 1 short. So this is called as an isochromosome. You can also have mosaicism. Mosaicism is a mix. Mosaicism is some normal chromosomes, some abnormal chromosomes. So you have a proper mixture of chromosomes and the resultant disease is also manifest in proportion of the abnormality. If the abnormal chromosomes are high, the disease manifestation is high. If they are less, disease manifestation is also less. Something called as ring chromosome. Ring chromosome is when this chromosome decides, okay, I am tired of being straight, let me do something funny. It chops off its end and
it joins like this. So this is called as a
ring chromosome. Again, not a useful chromosome. With that, we move on to advances in molecular genetics. DNA technology has rapidly progressed, as you all know, and right now we have DNA probes which sequence a particular part, so they identify a particular disease. If you want that area, they'll give you by DNA probes. You also have DNA sequencing. If you want to amplify that part or if you want to remove that part, you can do that. Restriction enzyme and polymerase chain reaction are the amplification reactions. Say for example, you have a PCR reaction for tuberculosis. So it locates the tuberculosis genetic material and it amplifies it so that it is easier to diagnose. That is polymerase chain reaction. Then you have therapeutic uses of these. Like we use E. coli to produce a lot of medicines these days. So what you do is that you produce insulin, erythropoietin, factor 8 by gene therapy. So you inject the gene which produces these factors, say for example insulin, into the bacteria. The bacteria multiplies, you lyse the bacteria, you get your insulin and your job is done. So you are using the gene DNA therapy or DNA technology for a lot of things including therapeutics. Then there is a new procedure called as fluorescent in situ hybridization, or also called as FISH, a fancy name. And you can also have gene therapy. Gene therapy has rapid advances, but still it is in its infancy. It probable diseases where gene therapy can help, number one would be cystic fibrosis. So gene therapy is the introduction of gene sequence into a diseased cell. So if I have a problem in a gene sequence of a diseased cell, what I try to do is I try to replace that pathological gene sequence with a normal and a healthy one, so that the cell regains the function that it was not having. That is basically what gene therapy is, very simply put. The aim is to modify the behavior of a cell in a clinically relevant fashion. Example, correct the mutation like you have in cystic fibrosis. So if you correct the mutation in cystic fibrosis, the patient's body takes care of itself. To kill a cell, say for example cancer, or to modify susceptibility to disease, say for example CHD. If we come to know the genetic loci of CHD, and if gene therapy helps us replacing them, it would be wonderful. The susceptibility of the CHD would automatically go down. So these are few of the indications that we can have, or few of the uses of gene therapy that we can have. Again, if you are asked what is the most common condition which is likely to be most benefited out of gene therapy, the answer would be cystic fibrosis. How is the gene introduced? The gene is introduced by using a virus, either an adenovirus or a retrovirus. So these are good viruses for introduction. This can also be asked. What virus is used for gene therapy? An adenovirus or a retrovirus can be used for gene therapy. Coming to the Human Genome Project, some advances you should be aware about. Human Genome Project, as you know, is a huge project for delineating the whole human genetic material, which we were very much proud of. But when the project was completed, we got the shock of our lives. We have less genetic information than a simple potato. It is insulting to us. Humans have lesser information than a potato. That is surprising, but that is true. So the genetic material that we have is basically very compact, and now we are trying to understand how can this less genetic material create something such big and such wonderful. So the Human Genome Project has told us that. Agencies involved: UNESCO Genome Database, HUGO, National Institute of Health, Department of Energy USA, MRC UK, Genethon France, and the European Union. So these are the agencies which were contributing for the Human Genome Project. Coming to HUGO, HUGO is the short form for Human Genome Diversity Project. Human Genome Diversity Project, and it is an organization which is aimed at increasing the understanding of human evolution. So HUGO is a project which is helping us to understand human evolution. Again, an MCQ can come on this. Coming to population genetics, every chapter, I mean at least for the small chapters, I am telling you some things which are really really important. And for this, if you have to bet your money, this is the slide you should bet your money on. Population genetics, somehow or the other, a lot of questions are asked on this topic in genetics. This is the line that I have boldened and highlighted and made big for you, and that is all that really matters. Very important. Okay, let us see what it is. Study of precise genetic component of population and its factor determinant is called as population genetics. So the factors which determine the genetic composition of the population. It is given by a very important law, which is called as a Hardy-Weinberg's law. It is called as a Hardy-Weinberg's law. And the law states the relative frequencies of each gene allele tend to remain constant from generation to generation in the absence of forces that change gene frequencies. So that is the Hardy-Weinberg law out for you. Very important. Now, let us see what are the factors influencing gene frequencies then. They are influenced by mutation, natural selection, population movement, breeding structure, and public health measure. Specifics are not given, so therefore, I made a slide for you to give the specifics so that you don't mess it up in the exam. Let us have a look at that slide. For a population to be at the Hardy equilibrium, you will have to have these characteristics. There should be no point mutations changing the genetic structure. There should be a large breeding population. Inbreeding should not be there. A small community inbreeding, not good. Okay, there should be a large breeding population, no mutation. There must be random mating. So mating should be random. There should be no immigration or emigration. So nobody from that population should go out, or nobody from other populations should join that population. And there should be no natural selection. This is really the odd one out. I have again highlighted it for you. For Hardy-Weinberg's law to be true, there should be no natural selection. Odd one out, please remember. Coming to the preventive and social measures. You have health promotional measures, which are eugenics and eunetics. Eugenics is basically science which aims to improve genetic endowment of the human population. This can be done by two ways: positive eugenics and negative eugenics. Negative eugenics is people suffering from serious hereditary disorders are not allowed to reproduce, so that those defective genes don't go to further generations. What you can do is you can have sterilizations, you have other methods of contraception, and on the other hand, what was done by the Hitler is also included in negative eugenics. Positive eugenics is improvement of genetic combinations by encouraging the carrier of desirable genotypes to assume the burden of parenthood, which means people who are healthy, smart, good looking, rich, polite, generous, whatever you want, make them have more kids so we have a better society. In practice, what you can do is artificial insemination, embryo donation, sperm donation, something of a wiki donor kind of scenario. So he has got those all good genetic traits, and he was asked to donate his sperms to a lot of girls so that they could have good babies. So that is positive eugenics. You identify a guy who has good characteristics and then you ask him or her to propagate. Problem with positive eugenics is that all good characters are not inherited. Many good characters are learned. So it is not a guarantee that Khurana was not giving abuses, the kid will also not give abuses. So all good characteristics are not inherited. And second, which gene we transmit to our children is not known. We are not very sure what we give to our children, and therefore the very quality you want might not go to the kid. So that can also happen. As I said, the other one is eugenics. Eugenics is basically modification of the environment for the betterment of the person rather than troubling the person himself. So mutual interaction of hereditary and environmental factors are necessary. This environmental manipulation for the flourishment of human beings is called as eugenics. So this is a more practicable approach, and an approach which is much less fraught with ethical problems as compared to eugenics. Coming to the genetic counseling. There are two types of genetic counseling: prospective genetic counseling and retrospective genetic counseling. Prospective genetic counseling is when I counsel people before they have kids. That is prospective genetic counseling. Heterozygous for any defect is prevented from marrying so that the children are protected. Say for example, you identify before marriage that two people are having sickle cell trait. So they can be informed that if you marry, your kid can have a sickle cell disease, and then the prognosis would not be very good. Similarly, we can do it for thalassemia. So this is prospective genetic counseling. They have no kid, we do it beforehand. Punnett square, this what we did, that capital A, small a, that square is called as a Punnett square, and we use it to know or to predict what genes will be passed in what conditions. So that is a basic question, but then if you don't know, you can miss it. This type of arrangement, the table that you see on your slides right now, is called as a Punnett square. Coming to the retrospective genetic counseling, as I said, retrospective means the child is already born. Somebody in the family has a genetic defect, and now you start the counseling. Hereditary disorder has already occurred in the family. Example is congenital anomaly, case of mental retardation, psychiatric illness, or some inborn error of metabolism. So this has already been happened. So now we start the genetic counseling, that is called as retrospective genetic counseling. Methods then available are contraception, medical termination of pregnancy in case the second child is also proven to be affected, and terminal sterilization. So these are options that are available at retrospective genetic counseling. Other genetic preventive measures logically prevent consanguineous marriages so that a homozygous state is prevented and people remain in their heterozygous state. So prevention of consanguineous marriages and prevention of late marriages to bring down the incidence of diseases like Down's syndrome, because we know that Down syndrome is highly associated with an increased maternal age. Specific protection, you have protection against X-rays in pregnancy, which is pretty standard nowadays, and immunization with anti-D if the mother is Rh negative. Otherwise, you can have a lot of diseases like Hydrops fetalis. So that can fortunately be prevented by immunization with anti-D. Early diagnosis and treatment of genetic carriers such as Duchenne's muscular dystrophy, hemophilia, phenylketonuria, and galactosemia is possible in today's day and age. A chart, rather a table in front of you, showing prenatal diagnosis indicators. Advanced maternal age, previous child with chromosomal aberrations, or intrauterine growth delay. What you can do is cytogenetics in the form of amniocentesis and chorionic villi sampling. For biochemical disorders, we can do protein assays and DNA diagnosis. For congenital anomaly, prenatally we can do a sonography, pretty standard these days. So what we screen is basically congenital anomaly. Screening for neural tube defects and trisomy, before I even say, you will be shouting their alpha fetoprotein, and you are right. So what we do is maternal serum, alpha fetoprotein, and chorionic gonadotropin.